Hello everybody, in this video I'm going to run through some of the key points that we can use in our Blade Runner meaning and essay, but also some of our contextual essays, specifically social and political context for Blade Runner. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to run through the PowerPoint, but I'm not going to read the slides, and some of the slides won't be on screen for very long. The idea with this video is that I can give you almost like an oral essay, and I'll explain how you can use some of the key contextual points and how you can link them to the key scenes and specific pieces of analysis. So this will work as like a spoken essay, and you should use this video to help plan and structure your own essay. And obviously we've studied all these issues in class, so feel free to use my points, the points we have on the PowerPoint, and feel free to embed them in your work, and I would actively encourage you. Okay, so let's get started. Okay, so see, these are some of the questions that this PowerPoint could address, and some of the questions that could come up in the exam and have come up in previous exams. And it's about explaining how films are a product of their time. And any question relating to contextual issues is effectively how does the film reflect the time in which it was made? And that can be a general statement. It can ask you about how does it reflect the political landscape, issues of representation, representation of nation. But effectively, the question is asking where does your film sit within its cultural, political, and social context, and how does it deal with those issues? Okay, so some key terms that we're going to use in our essays: dystopia, capitalism, consumerism, environmentalism. And these four words are front and center in the PowerPoint and in the lesson, is because I expect to see them in your work. Use dystopia in your opening paragraph to explain the aesthetic adopted by Ridley Scott, and also you can make some points about genre, and that'll set up your criticism of capitalism, consumerism, and the environmental issues in the film, because they are presented as dystopian elements. So in your introduction, what you don't want to do is labour the point, and what you don't want to do is start answering the question. The introduction, you should refer back to the question and spend a very, very limited amount of time contextualizing your answer. So these are some of the points I would try and embed within your introduction. You don't have to copy these word for word because it'll be too long, but you should try and make this quite concise. So say, Blade Runner is a cyberpunk film, a subgenre of science fiction. Science fiction is a speculative fiction genre that allows filmmakers to draw upon the present and predict what will happen in the future. Blade Runner, when released in the early 80s, used the cyberpunk aesthetic to explore the potential negative effects of technological growth, the rise of consumerism, and our relationship with advanced technology. And those final points are what you are going to explore and analyze in your essay. Okay, so this is just a list of the ways that we consider the Blade Runner to be dystopian. Now, we're not going to refer to all of these in our essay, but these are points that you can build upon and develop in your own work. Okay, so as I said, the key content or the key points for this essay are environmental destruction, corporations run the world, or the rise of capitalism and corporate power in America following Reagan's economic policies. We look at the effects on the individual, and we look at the rise of consumerism and how Blade Runner makes predictions about the way that's going, basically. So again, some context, not necessarily required for your essay, this amount of detail, but the point with these slides and the point you should make is that in the 1970s, it was a very, very bleak decade in America. And as we move into the 80s, America was coming off the back of war, political scandal, environmental disaster, suppression of citizens, right-wing politicians gaining power, and political assassination. So it was a very, very bleak time. And that was all under the well, it wasn't all under that. We had Richard Nixon, but at the end of the decade, Jimmy Carter took over. And as you can see, he was an idealist, but in reality, it led to declining American economy, unemployment, and inflation. And we have hostage crises, and basically, a just growing sense of dissatisfaction with politicians and the political system. And very similar to our modern time with the election of Donald Trump, the American voters reacted to that with more of a populist president and the elected former film star Ronald Reagan. Now, in the lesson, we look at some of his commercials or adverts for his political campaign, and he basically promises an optimistic future, the reduction of the number of government jobs, reduction of government control, a fresh outside look. So what he means by that is he's going to invite private corporations and private business people into a democratic system like the government to give insight and to help make the economy run a lot more efficiently, basically. Okay, so Reagan was elected president on the 20th of January 1981, and he believed that government is not a solution, it's a problem. So you don't need all of this information in your essay, but the point is that when Reagan came in, he deregulated lots of democratic governmental institutions, and this means that he removed government control and allowed corporate or private corporate entities to come in and operate as if they were the government and guide the government and even take over certain institutions. One of the most basic ways we can point this out in the film is that the police in the film seem to be working for a private corporation, not the government. In fact, in Blade Runner, there's no mention of a democratic or, you know, government in a traditional sense. It seems like the private corporation of Tyrell, a governed society. And that's, again, quite basic, but our first indication that this is a film that critiques the political and social climate of 1980s America. Okay, so the specific points we can focus on in our essay is the Environmental Protection Agency and the destruction of the natural habitat that really, you know, it didn't begin in the 80s, but it really sort of moved up to a new level in the 80s. So when, and again, just like Trump, in modern times, there's a lot of, you know, comparison there, is that one of the first things Reagan did when he came into office was get deregulate and try to dismantle the Environmental Protection Agency. Now, the role of the Environmental Protection Agency is to protect the natural environment, and this includes the state parks and the large national parks. They were protected. So what happened is that with the deregulation, the EPA had budget cuts, number of staff reduced significantly. Public lands, such as the national parks, were made available for private drilling and mining. And we're still seeing the effects of that now with the fracking debate. You know, that is all part of Reagan's legacy. And Reagan believed that private corporations, when left alone, would regulate themselves and solve the pollution problem without the need of government. Now, there's a number of ways to look at that. You can argue, you could say, you know, oh, maybe Reagan was a bit naive or he was misguided. But I think the reality is he was just telling a straight up lie. And there's no way that a private corporation would, you know, look after the environment unless there were very strict penalties in place imposed by governments, you know. Okay, so the deregulation of the environment has led to a rise in man-made ecological disasters. It allows companies like BP to drill in, you know, certain places, and then, you know, all these accidents that take place cause massive ecological disasters. And on screen, there's a load of examples of ecological disasters that are man-made that have happened since Reagan's political policies were enacted in America. Okay, so linking back to Blade Runner, with the introduction of Reagan's policies, we see the destruction of the environmental agency, and what is replaced by that is corporate power. Now, corporations did not, in fact, regulate themselves, and they sort of, you know, basically approach nature with like a blitzkrieg approach. It's like, let's get as much out of this natural environment as we can. And what we see in the 80s is a massive rise in environmental issues. We have air pollution, lead poisoning in humans. We have a phenomenon called acid rain, which is a direct consequence of increased number of you know, toxins in the atmosphere through from smokestacks and through you know, corporate growth. We have smog in cities, as you see LA in the images on screen. We have increased rates of asthma, and we have destruction of animal habitats. All these things are happening as a result of Reagan's political policies. Okay. Now, these specific issues are expressed in Blade Runner, and we can identify them in a few moments, but I thought I'd put this point in. This is a quote from Hampton Fancher, and this you can use this quote in your essay to show that this isn't our interpretation of a film, and we're not sort of connecting dots or making points that aren't really there. This is evidence for our essay that strengthens the argument that this film is an active critique of the increasing environmental destruction taking place as a result of corporate growth. So, Fancher himself said that basically when he was a younger person in the 60s, he took LSD, got into hippie culture, he built their connection with nature, and he realized that, you know, the natural world was being destroyed. And the quote says, "Oh shit, this is the end of nature. I wanted to blow the whistle a bit. I mean, I wasn't seriously blowing the whistle. I'm just a pipsqueak. Everyone's a pipsqueak, but I wanted to do something." So this is the writer of the film telling you he embedded environmental messages into his film, even though he himself says it probably is not going to make a difference. He felt like he should make a stand. So you can draw on Fancher's quote to support your point. And the scene I'd like you to analyze, or I suggest to to, you know, show evidence of this environment to critique is the opening scene. So you might want to pause the video, watch that on YouTube, and come back. Okay, so analytical points for our essay. Sunny Los Angeles has been replaced by a bleak, oppressive, dark, toxic, dystopian wasteland. Symbols of industry dominate the skyline. And basically what we are introduced to is an industrial hellscape. You know, this is Los Angeles. Everyone in the world knows Los Angeles, or at least, you know, in the Western world, because we're so used to seeing images of it in media and film in particular. And it's a place of opportunity. It's the home of Hollywood. It's, you know, sunshine 365 days a year. We all know what it looks like. So to be greeted with such a stark counterpoint to that is quite powerful on screen. And so what we're shown is not only the environmental destruction, the massive increase in corporate power as well. And if we look at the Tyrell building that is shaped like a pyramid. And the pyramid, obviously, in our society has certain connotations. We think about your pyramid schemes, it resembles a hierarchy, but effectively it's a symbol of power. And that symbol of power is a corporate symbol, and it sits at the very center of LA 2019. And what's interesting about the camera is that we're slowly drawn in towards it. So you might want to make a point that, you know, it's almost like these corporations, or Tyrell Corporation, has so much power in this world that even the camera itself is affected by it. You know, so it's starting to even affect the outside of the diegesis, if you like. So it's a very, very strong symbol of corporate power. And you might want to use a great phrase to describe the Tyrell Corporation. It's called a corporateocracy, and that is a term that really basically says that society's been taken over by a corporation and they run society. Okay, so some more points for you to think about. And then we have further examples in the film that you can draw from. You know, we have the accelerated decrepitude line. Many inhabitants like J.F. Sebastian suffer aging because of the poor environment. And there's more points online that you can build upon. Okay, then we move on to our second paragraph or our second point, which is a more active and direct critique of capitalism and consumerism. So consumerism is the social economic order that encourages the acquisition of goods and services. And basically it says that a person's well-being and happiness is determined by their material possessions and their financial, you know, their bank account, basically. So there are many pros and cons to that argument that are explored on this slide. But we're just going to think about the negatives. Okay, so I would talk about in this part of the essay is how Reagan's deregulation allowed corporations to grow, and that means that they could exploit nature and make more products. And by making more products, that increased demand for stuff, you know, stereos, cars, fashion, whatever it is. And in the 80s, we see a massive rise of consumerism and of consumer culture. And what Ridley Scott is pointing out in the mise en scène or aesthetic of his film is that these symbols of consumerism, like the adverts, like the Coke adverts in particular, they just dominate the skyline. And if we look around the world at modern, you know, mega cities like London, New York City, Tokyo, Hong Kong, if you look at cities like that now, they all look quite similar. They're all full of large billboards, electronic billboards, all promoting the same products. And, you know, the world that is depicted in Blade Runner 2019 is actually very close to what we have now, minus the flying cars. So the point I would make is that, look, Ridley Scott drapes the mise-en-scene of capitalism and capitalist ideology across the landscape of LA 2019. Adverts dominate the mise-en-scene of the film, depicting a dystopian view of US consumerist society. It dominates every aspect of life. And then we've also got a point now that we can use to come on to our next main point, is that the prevalence of Chinese and Japanese adverts in the film is a comment on the growth of Japanese tech companies, basically. So the deregulation of the American markets allowed non-American companies to enter America, like Sony. So, you know, it's about offering cheaper products, offering better quality products. And the consequence of that actually is that a lot of those jobs making electronics left America because Americans were buying non-American products, basically. So we have a decrease in American output, but it also leads to something called a homogenized culture, which is means to make uniforms similar or the same. So basically, foreign companies started to invest more heavily in America, and they became much more prevalent. And as those products were spread around the world, what we find is that all major cities and all cultures start to seem very, very similar. You know, effectively, we're talking about globalization. And that is seen in Blade Runner. through a number of ways. Number one, we've got a lot of Asian, Japanese, and Chinese neon signs everywhere, and the city itself is made up of the denizens of the city come from very, very different cultural and ethnic backgrounds. So we've got a very, very multicultural city, not just in terms of the makeup of people, but also in the mise-en-scene, and that is again a visual signifier of a homogenized culture that has been caused by a rise of consumerism and capitalist culture. The whole world is turning into one nation basically, or one culture. Other ways that this is shown in the film is our character of Gaff, played brilliantly by Edward James Olmos. Gaff is seen periodically throughout the film, and he speaks in a language called City Speak. This is a language that the actor almost himself invented, and it's a combination of Japanese, Spanish, German, and Hungarian. And the idea behind his character and his language is to show that there is no overriding culture in America anymore. There is no American culture. What we have is a global culture, and that has been enabled by Reagan's deregulation and the rise of consumerism. And again, you can watch a video which Edward James almost explains the origins of the language. Okay, and our final paragraph deals with a very specific aspect of Reagan's policies called trickle-down economics, otherwise known as Reaganomics. So trickle-down economics is an economic theory or approach that argues that if taxes on businesses and the wealthy are reduced, it will stimulate economic growth, and the wealthy will invest in new businesses. So the idea is basically you let someone like Apple or a giant corporation pay very, very little tax. That money they would have spent on tax, they will reinvest in their business. And by reinvesting in their business, they create jobs. And by creating jobs, that money trickles down from the rich to the poor. And the idea is that if we let the rich get richer, the entire society's level will be raised. Now, what we're not going to do in this essay is get into a debate about the pros and cons of trickle-down economics. We're just going to look at the real-world effects in the 80s and how that is reflected in the film of Blade Runner. So the scenes I would suggest you watch are the penthouse scene where Roy takes JF, or JF Sebastian takes Roy and Pris to see Tyrell and murders him. And I would compare that with the street level scene where Deckard is chasing Pris, sorry, chasing Zora. Now the events of the scenes are not really relevant. What we're really looking at is mise-en-scene and the aesthetic of each individual environment and how they juxtapose to reveal a critique. Okay, so let's do this very quickly. Tyrell is a symbol of corporate power. He is the most powerful person in society because he runs and maintains the largest corporation. Now, when we go to his tower, he literally sits at the top of a pyramid. So again, there's connotations of power and hierarchies there. And look, if you want to get into that sort of metaphor or that representation or the symbolism in a deeper level, you can make points about, the pyramids were supposedly built by slaves and they have connotations of slavery being used to build these massive corporations. And basically, it's talking about exploitation there as well. But it's sitting in the center of the city, which again reflects his power. And Scott is showing us huge wealth gaps that emerge under Reagan's consumerist society. So as corporations get richer, people get richer, and they elevate themselves and move up society and increase their status. But what that also does is that creates a gap between the rich and the poor. So as the rich get richer, it didn't actually turn out that the trickle-down worked, and the poor got poorer. So we have this juxtaposition between this like heavenly, almost idyllic, utopian, Edenic environment that Tyrell sits within because of his wealth and his corporate power. And on the street level, we have a grimy, overpopulated, like diseased population, basically. The poor exist in a chaotic, consumer-obsessed society in which people are ill, selfish, and struggling to survive. I mean, in the scene we're looking at, we literally have police officers run around murdering people or replicants, and no one really bats an eyelid. So the street level is a place of it's a debased level basically, and we can juxtapose that with the Tyrell headquarters. So there we get a critique of the trickle-down economics where wealth is hoarded at the top of the system and those at the bottom are left to fend for themselves, and that goes against what Reagan promised. So again, by showing and juxtaposing those two environments, Ridley Scott reveals his critique of trickle-down economics and the idea that, making the rich richer will actually help the poor. He's presenting an opposite idea. And we see that now in our modern society, the wealth gap has increased. More and more of the world's wealth is hoarded by fewer and fewer people. More and more people are in poverty. So again, this Blade Runner is incredibly prophetic, and your essay that this video addresses is dealing with the prophetic nature of the film and how Ridley Scott saw what was going on and predicted the world we live in today. Okay, so I will just run through this very quickly on screen. These are some points that you can use. Well, it's an essay plan, and these are some points that you can use in your essay. So again, I will attach a PowerPoint link, a link to the PowerPoint below this video. So you can pause this video if you want to look at it or access the lesson below. But that should act as a very brief overview of the key contextual issues for the questions on screen and Blade Runner's contextual issues. Now, obviously, it's not comprehensive. You'll have to read the slides, add your own points, develop the analysis. But that structure I have just explained should follow that and use that as like the spine and structure of your essay. And then you can fill in the gaps with some analysis and some other points. And you should have a pretty solid essay response to those questions.